two decades into the 21st century. Why don't we yet have the floating vehicles graphically foretold and envisioned in futuristic popular culture? The hover cars and hoverboards of Back to the Future and Total Recall? The high-flying spinners of Blade Runner? Nothing of the kind yet graces our skies or the spaces just above our roadbeds. The truth is, though, is that we do have the basic technology to create these gravity-defying marvels. There are people who are working on real hoverboards and floating vehicles based on magnetic levitation. But one of the main issues is that the progress of this work is not consistently made visible to the public. As they say, out of sight, out of mind. Regular people and investors need to see it as a viable technology. We'll discuss some ways that we might make this possible shortly. But first, let's look at the concept itself. As mentioned in my previous video entitled Personal Levitation Vehicle, or PLV, antigravity would be the ultimate realization of terrestrial travel, being able to either cancel out or repel a gravitational field would be ideal. This concept is common in science fiction. Star Wars, for instance, is replete with flying vehicles fitted with what is called Repulsorlift technology. Repulsorlifts were a type of antigravity technology which worked by pushing against external gravitational fields or gravity wells. Since all matter has mass and therefore a gravitational field, the repulsor lifts could lift a vehicle by repelling this field, if the field was large enough, as it would be on the surface of a planet. As vehicles fitted with these incredible devices were seen hovering effortlessly, even when parked, it is safe to assume that repulsor lifts either require minimal power to operate or that the power to energize them was both easily obtainable and plentiful, perhaps even inexhaustible. Vehicles as small as two-person deal to vehicles as large as small cities were seen floating effortlessly from just above the surface to great heights in the atmosphere of a planet. But coming back to present reality, magnetic levitation, or maglev, could somewhat approximate this technology, though there are considerable technical challenges. Let's look at a few of the requirements we would need to approximate repulsor lifts of Star Wars. First, of course, is hovering height. I believe that the ideal hovering height should be at minimum between 2 to 3 feet above the Earth's surface, significantly higher than that of maglev trains, but not so high that a person could walk under it. It should hover high enough to be able to clear most obstacles and irregularities in the surface, but not so high that there would be collateral damage underneath them should there be the occasional mid-air collisions and aerial accidents. In order to create a system like this using electromagnetic coils, a large amount of energy needs to be converted into a powerful magnetic field. So we are looking at conductors and magnet wires made from high-temperature superconducting material with a high saturation point. A high saturation point will ensure that the superconductive state does not break down under high magnetic flux. Using superconductors, there will be little to no energy loss through heat in the maglev circuitry and the flux generators. To maximize the repulsor field brings us to the next technical challenge, the power source. Powerful but lightweight advanced batteries would be needed, which would provide super dense DC currents that would be modulated by frequency generators. This will convert the steady DC currents into time-varying DC or AC currents. These currents should then enter a parallel tank circuit, which includes the flux levitation coils themselves and capacitors. Tuning the time-varying currents to the resonant frequency of the parallel tank circuits will amplify these currents several times beyond what could be achieved by the power source alone. The result would be super strong magnetic fields, which will induce super strong eddy currents within the conductors embedded in the ground, with the accompanying counter magnetic fields, which will levitate the conveyance just above the Earth's surface via Lenz's law. And as mentioned before, as well as demonstrated here, technology can be combined with the environment by concealing the non-ferrous metal conductors within the Earth's natural landscape just beneath the surface, as magnetic fields can pass through sand, soil, sticks, and small stones. The result is a near approximation of sci-fi antigravity. The third main parameter for approximating antigravity with maglev is stability. Stability is especially important as we don't want to have to use external guide rails around the vehicles, which will require extra materials. We want the conveyances to be able to be stably suspended in midair just above the Earth. Practical stability could be achieved in at least a couple ways. One could be by using jet-type thrusters located around the periphery of the craft, and could be based on using jet fuel, compressed air, or even cold gas, and controlled via a computer, just like in the EVA spacesuits. Gyroscopes built into the craft body could also help by reducing momentum caused by roll, pitch, and yaw, which would add another factor potentially propelling the levitating craft off course. There might also be even a way to utilize the Earth's magnetic field for stability. The geomagnetic field has both horizontal and vertical force components, as demonstrated by the actions of the compass and the dip needle, respectively. This is also demonstrated in magnetotorquers, which are small solenoids that are placed on the bottoms of satellites and help in repositioning them, utilizing interactions with the Earth's magnetic field. The question is, could magnetotorquers be as effective in interacting with the Earth's magnetic field on the Earth's surface as they are in space? Much more research would need to be conducted into this area to see if it's practical or reliable. Still, another stabilization method is electromagnetic stabilization, a way of modifying the levitating eddy currents themselves. In the following series of short clips, I show practical ways of increasing levitation height and strength, as well as stability. All right, so this is a magnetic coil. It is about 3.5 inches in diameter, and it is made of 24 gauge wire. It's made in kind of like a trifler style, which is basically like three wires, three spools that were wound simultaneously around a core. And so what I have is, you know, you end up having, of course, two power lines per coil. And so each of those go into the socket here. So each line gets 120 volts between all three of them. And they're energized in a way so that they add. And so what you get is it gets a much stronger magnetic field than if just using one core or one coil. So it's basically three coils in one. Okay, this here is an aluminum plate. It's about 1/2 inches thick, and it's about 10 by 12. And so what I'm going to do is put the coil directly over there and energize it, and we see you get the levitation. So of course, an issue with this type of levitation, of course, is a stability issue. We saw that in the last little demonstration there, and how it's bouncing around quite a bit, quite erratically. Seems like the coil has a tendency to move towards the edges rather than staying directly over the plates. So towards our quest for stability, we can see, so anyway, we'll see here that the coil has a tendency to try to move towards the closest edge. And so we'll see here that the core is going to move directly toward that closest edge, which is to its left. So try to put it in the middle there, and you see that it has that tendency to go left. Now this here, this on the left plate, you see it, it has a tendency to move to the right. So whichever the closest edge is, it'll try to move towards that. All right, so we saw how the coil has the tendency to try to move towards the closest edge. So let's see what happens when we put the two edges kind of closer together and see what happens. Turn the coil on. So, and now, look what we have here. A little more stability. So what happens when we put them all the way together? Turn the coil on. So, kind of a similar thing there. Has a tendency to kind of, let's see. Okay, so we just saw how putting the coil over the slit kind of results in the plates kind of being pushed apart. And so what I did is kind of just tape them together. And so let's try it again. All right, so see, so from either side I have it, the coil seems to find that equilibrium point right there on the slit. Right there on the slit. So up and down, so it's stable in this direction. And so as we can see, there was complete stability laterally or from left to right, but it was still able to move kind of in the direction along the slit, parallel to the slit. And so that's very useful. The only thing is that, you know, we saw that the levitation height decreased dramatically from a few inches to probably about a fraction of an inch. And so what we saw there is we pretty much traded levitation height for stability along the slit, so the slit plane. And so we see this when in laminated core material. And so the whole purpose of laminating the core material, say like a transformer core, is to reduce the energy losses due to circulating eddy currents. And so rather than having really large and strong eddy currents, which dissipate a lot of energy, what they do is break up the transformer core into laminations. And so basically you take like similar tape type of shape of the core, and you know, you basically break it up into many different parts. You insulate each part, and then you put it back together. You end up with this this laminated core material. And so rather than having really large circulating eddy currents, you have much smaller circulating eddy currents. And so since the currents are kind of broken up on each side of this, you have weaker eddy currents, and thus you have weaker magnetic field that's produced due to those eddy currents, and you get less levitation height. And so one way to rectify that is to, we could either make the, so these are 1/2 inch plates. And so we could get 1 inch plates, the same size, but just thicker. Or we could take another plate and just simply put it under, right along the slit. So let me do that here. Alright, so what I did is I put another 1/2 inch thick aluminum plate right under the slit, and so we'll see if that makes any difference as far as the levitation height. I'll turn the coil on. Alright, and so there we see. And so we've maintained much of the levitation height. We also have we keep the stability. Now the stability force isn't quite as strong as it was before, but it's still there. and we kind of regained some of that levitation height. And so, and given the eddy currents, a little bit more thickness within which to circulate, and so we're able to regain some of the lost levitation height. This would be invaluable in any type of levitating vehicle based on these principles. And so, you know, because without stability, it simply won't be practical. Now, another stability trick would be to get the coil to just hover and have a stability from all from each axis. And way we can do that is just by making, instead of having one slit, we have another slit that's perpendicular to the first one, and basically making like a T. And so what I do is I got two other aluminum plates. So I put them together like this. And then I'm going to take the other one and put it over that one. This way, actually. Yeah. Okay. So the plates under it form a slit this way, and then these cut perpendicular across. And so let's see what happens now. The coil's on, and there we go. So we have a coil stable in each little direction there. So we are able to see from the clips that there is decent clearance given the materials used. But stability while maintaining levitation height is particularly challenging. But by using what I've named the three-coil compensation method, we can get both stability and regain levitation height. I demonstrate that technique in the next clip. Okay, so we know what happens when we put a coil over a slit, and so we do get stability, but we get less lift. And so one of the ways I try to devise around that is to put two coils on either side of the stabilizing coil that will kind of help us regain some of that lift. And so let's see what happens when we turn on just the outside coils and see what happens. Alright, so we see there that we got virtually very little stability. And so we'll see what happens when we turn on all three coils and we have the stabilizing coil as well as the lift coils on the outside. So it's all there that we had much more stability. And so the center coil kept the contraption basically kind of over the slit, even though there was a little bit of turning like this, but still the contraption stayed right in the middle there rather than like veering off to the side like it was before. So this three-coil compensation method seems to be a viable technique, at least on this scale. Of course, it would also require the craft to remain in a fixed path over the stabilizing slit. But what if we needed to swerve or deviate from this fixed path? This could be achieved by simply switching the center stabilizing coil off temporarily and using small thrusters to steer the craft until the driver is ready to continue along the fixed path again, by repositioning the stabilizer coil over the slit and reactivating it. A more effective way to use this technique may involve using two slits instead of one, like that shown in the following diagram. Here the two outer coils are the stabilizers, with the center coil being the main lift coil. In fact, this setup would prevent unwanted rotation, which would be a potential issue in the single slit technique, unless, of course, a second stabilization coil were added in a triangular configuration. This would eliminate any unwanted rotation in the single slit technique. But for steering in a double slit method, steering would be achieved by deactivating the two outer coils instead of the center one, using thrusters to steer and then return to stabilization by repositioning the outer coils back over the slits and then reactivating those coils. These slit techniques are not the only stabilization method or necessarily the best, but they do show that the concept is at least possible. Since the maglev craft will likely use peripheral thrusters anyway for both propulsion and braking, it might be more practical to simply use the thrusters for steering as well. But speaking of propulsion, a non-thruster technique could be added, could be involved using extra coils as shown and activating them in a multiphasic sequence, effectively turning the levitated vehicle into a suspended linear motor. Hoverboards could also use this linear motor technique, or they could use thrusters. But for hoverboards in particular, there's one last parameter that is needed. In order to fully realize the hoverboard concept, it must have both adequate levitation height in addition to elastic compressibility. The levitation field must be able to be compressed and to spring back as shown here. This property would allow hover experts to be able to perform the same incredible acrobatic feats that we associate with experts on regular skateboards. This elastic compressibility is something that I don't yet see in the existing prototypes here. These are already incredible inventions. All they need now is to significantly increase the levitation height, as well as the elastic compressibility of the levitation field. This will likely be a long-term vision, however, as there will probably be little initial profit as this technology is taking off. But if we begin to show the public this technology in a very visual and creative way, then perhaps they will be able to see the potential of magnetic levitation as a practical mode of conveyance. This in turn should spark a diversification of innovation and ideas. Progress is sure to follow rapidly. Developing hover rinks where people can rent hoverboards and ride them around on a hidden conglomerate of non-ferrous metal tracks. Futuristic amusement parks with personal levitation vehicles in which people can float around on a model futuristic town. Levitation crafts with themes based on movies such as Back to the Future, Star Wars, Star Trek, Blade Runner, and Minority Report, etc., can also be created. This will capture the fascination and imagination of the public. Curiosity would be the driving force. When profit is the primary force, on the other hand, relatively little diversification of innovation and ideas is often generated, as the paradigm will only go with what is cheapest and already proven to work. We must occasionally put human advancement in the front seat instead. Also, once we start employing the forces of electromagnetism and even sonic vibrations on a level several orders higher, we will likely stumble upon subtle interactions between these forces and gravity. We can then analyze these interactions so that we can duplicate and harness them at will. If antigravity is indeed possible, we will likely discover or stumble upon it when employing these better understood forces for levitation at energy levels many orders higher than what we currently use. Now, speaking of energy usage, there's actually a hypothetical scale that is used to rank the technological advancement of a civilization by ranking the amount of energy that is able to harness, store, and utilize at will. This concept is called the Kardashev civilization scale and typically ranges from 0 to about 3. The idea is that the higher a civilization ranks on this scale, the greater the amount of energy that it controls, and thus the more sophisticated it must be. A type 0 civilization is one that has yet to harness all of the energy output of its home planet. This type of civilization is likely still using unsustainable energy sources such as fossil fuels. Type 0 is where our civilization on Earth is right now. A type 1 civilization, on the other hand, is able to harness and store all of the energy arriving at its planet from its star or sun. This means fully utilizing all sources of energy, including solar energy, radiant energy, wind and water energy, all of which are ultimately generated and provided by the sun. If we become a type 1 civilization, we will even be able to harness the titanic energy provided by storms such as hurricanes and tsunamis. Hurricanes, for instance, store and release energy in both its winds and the evaporation of water. Most of this energy is released through the formation of clouds and rain. The document here calculates an amount of energy equivalent to 5.2 times 10 to the 19th joules every single day of its run. This is 1/10 of the Earth's production of energy for the entire year of 2013. An average hurricane produces this amount of energy every single day, and it does not include the amount of energy produced by the hurricane's winds, which are estimated to produce an additional 1.3 times 10 to the 17th joules per day. Another way of quantifying the tremendous nature of this energy is to compare it to a more familiar action, such as raising a weight. Let's take the Great Pyramid of Giza, which weighs about 6.5 million tons, which is 130 billion pounds. If we wanted to raise the entire pyramid 1 mile into the air, it would take 6.86 times 10 to the 13 foot-pounds, which is 9.307 times 10 to the 13 joules of energy. Dividing this number into our aforementioned water vapor energy figure of 5.2 times 10 to the 19th joules, we would find that we could raise the Great Pyramid 1 mile into the sky over 1.5 million times each day of the existence of the hurricane. So we can see that by utilizing only a fraction of this vast energy, we could lift practically any amount of weight that we wanted. Levitating vehicles of any weight would be the tip of the iceberg. It's all a matter of energy, and this energy is all around us. We just need to develop the systems to harness and store it, as well as to create durable conduits that can both contain and withstand the release of this energy. We also have to do so in a way that does not interfere with the Earth's natural weather cycles and rhythms, since strong storms and their winds help to redistribute energy, which it maintains the atmospheric equilibrium and temperature stability throughout the Earth. But once again, all of this energy is ultimately provided by the sun. Estimations for the sun's energy is 430 billion billion joules of energy each and every hour. This is 3.76 trillion trillion joules per year. So needless to say, we are grossly underutilizing the planetary energy available to us by many, many orders of magnitude. I would also go on to say that we are equally underutilizing our human potential. To become a Type 1 civilization capable of transforming the destructive power of superstorms to constructive purposes, we also need to redevelop our social and economic systems such that all peoples of the Earth have the truly equal opportunity to develop themselves to their fullest potentials. I won't go on a social justice rant here, but it is clear that in order to truly advance as a species, We need to make full use of both environmental and human energy. Now, once we can do this, there will be virtually no weight that we could not lift or levitate. As long as we could construct mechanisms large enough and energize them with enough power. And when we are not busy moving mountains and lifting city-sized space stations into orbit, we could simply relax in distress by speed-floating our pod racers and land speeders across the desert floor.